herzlich willkommen heißen zu unserer Veranstaltung heute Abend am Jahrestag der Schiffskatastrophe auf dem Mittelmeer vor der griechischen Küstenstadt Pylos. Schiffskatastrophe ist der Ausdruck, der eigentlich in den Medien oft benutzt wird, der benutzt wird, oftmals auch um vielleicht nicht genauer zu bezeichnen, was dort eigentlich passiert ist vor genau einem Jahr. Denn wenn man genauer betrachtet, was in Pylos vor einem Jahr geschehen ist, kann man das nicht als Katastrophe bezeichnen, es ist ein Verbrechen. Die 600 Menschen, die vor genau einem Jahr in den Gewässern vor Pylos ertrunken sind, sich zum großen Teil bis heute in diesem Schiffswrack aufhalten, am Grunde des Mittelmeers niemals geborgen wurden. Diese Toten sind kein Zufall. Es war ein Verbrechen verursacht durch die griechische Küstenwache, durch andere Institutionen. Wir werden heute Abend zum Gegenstand machen dieses Verbrechen mit Gästen, die wir eingeladen haben. Ich möchte aber zuerst ganz herzlich begrüßen hier unter uns die 20 Überlebenden, die heute in Berlin sind, die heute Nachmittag auf Einladung von Pro Asyl eine koordiniert, die Arbeit beim Bündnis Griechenland Solidarität. Und ich möchte jetzt direkt auch an ihn weitergeben, keine weiteren Worte hier verlieren. Wir gehen jetzt direkt in das Thema rein. Vielen Dank, dass Sie heute Abend hier angekommen sind in der Stiftung. Es ist ein schwieriger Abend, nicht nur aufgrund des Wetters, sondern auch aufgrund der Fußball-Weltmeisterschaften. Aber vielleicht gibt es was Wichtigeres als Fußball heute Abend. Dankeschön.
Hört man mich jetzt? Ja. Ja, herzlich willkommen jetzt von unserer Seite als Veranstalter. Mein Name hat Boris dankenswerterweise auch schon genannt, Georg Boska. Das Bündnis Griechenland Solidarität Berlin ist wahrscheinlich nicht sehr bekannt. Wir informieren seit 10 Jahren über Politik in Griechenland. Wir machen das in erster Linie mit vielen Veranstaltungen und in zweiter Linie mit dieser Internetseite, griechenlandsoli.com. Es ist tatsächlich ein Bündnis. Es ist ein Bündnis von folgenden 4 Initiativen. Dem Arbeitskreis Internationalismus der IG Metall Berlin, der gewerkschaftlichen Griechenland-Soli-Reisengruppe, der Griechenland AG von Attac Berlin und von dem Verein Soli Oli. Das sind alles kleine und feine Organisationen. Wir wären nicht in der Lage, so eine Veranstaltung allein zu stemmen. Und wir haben in erster Linie zu danken der Rosa-Luxemburg-Stiftung für die großartige Unterstützung und Pro Asyl für ebenfalls eine sehr gute Unterstützung. Und dann kommen aber noch mehr Gruppen dazu. Das kann man hier auf der Collage sehen, dass uns viele Organisationen auch noch weiter unterstützt haben. Das muss ich, damit ich keinen vergessen, muss ich das ablesen. Attac Deutschland, Bildungswerk Berlin der Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung, Borderline Europe, die Gruppe Arbeiterpolitik und der Verein Respekt für Griechenland. Vor einem Jahr haben wir, das Bündnis Griechenland Solidarität Berlin, genau hier in diesem Raum auch eine Veranstaltung gemacht. Da sind noch mehr Leute gekommen, da sind 150 Leute gekommen. Das war zur Thematik Urbanisierung Griechenlands, autoritäre Tendenzen. Man kann sich vorstellen, ein wesentlicher Teil dieser Veranstaltung ging um dasselbe Thema wie heute. Es ging um die Gewalt gegen Menschen auf der Flucht. Also das Thema ist nicht neu. Diese Gewalt-Pushback erfolgen täglich in vielen Ländern, unter anderem in Griechenland. Das Pylos-Verbrechen ist nur der vorläufige, grausame Tiefpunkt der allgemeinen Gewalt gegen Geflüchtete. Täglich werden Menschen mit Gewalt und häufig auch unter Gefahr, ihr Leben zu verlieren, an den europäischen Grenzen zurückgedrängt. Der Pilos-Fall ragt nur heraus durch seine Dimension, durch sein Extrem. Ich gebe jetzt nur noch einen kurzen Überblick darüber, was euch Sie jetzt erwartet heute Abend. Wir haben diese drei wunderbaren Personen neben mir eingeladen, allesamt Griechen, allesamt arbeiten für Forschungsinstitute, die hervorragende, sehr gründliche, sehr erfolgreiche Forschung über diesen Fall geleistet haben. Die werden zuerst was sagen, danach werden zwei von den Überlebenden hier aufs Podium kommen und werden uns berichten. Dann wird Tarek Aloas von Pro Asyl über die allgemeine asylpolitische Situation reden. Und dann zuletzt wird Gelegenheit für Fragen und für Bemerkungen sein. Wie gesagt, wir haben vor einem Jahr hier eine Veranstaltung gemacht zum Thema, zur Thematik Urbanisierung Griechenlands. Da ging es natürlich wesentlich darum, dass der Rechtsstaat in Griechenland erodiert. Er wird geschleift. In einem Rechtsstaat ist es so, dass Gerichte diejenigen, die Verbrechen begehen, zur Verantwortung ziehen. Das sehen wir in diesem Fall nach einem Jahr nicht. Noch nicht. Stattdessen sind es unabhängige Forschungsinstitute und Medienorgane, die untersuchen, was passierte. Unsere drei griechischen Gäste werden Ihnen jetzt darüber berichten. Ich gebe gerne weiter an zuerst, ich stelle sie kurz vor, Dimitra Andritsou. Sie ist Senior-Forscherin bei Forensis, der in Berlin angesiedelten Organisation von Forensic Architecture. Sie war Mitglied des Forschungsteams zu Pilos. Genau für diese Recherche hat sie zusammen mit ihren KollegInnen den Daphne Caruana Galizia-Preis des Europäischen Parlaments für Journalismus im Dienste der Grundrechte bekommen. Außerdem, gerade vor einer Woche, wurde diese Forschung mit einem anderen Preis ausgezeichnet, nämlich mit dem zweiten Platz in der Kategorie Migration des Europäischen Pressepreises. Ich stelle jetzt schon die anderen beiden auch schon mal vor, weil das ist ein bisschen mehr im Übergang, dass die Beiträge, die sie machen werden, es wäre blöd, wenn ich das durch eine Vorstellung unterbrechen würde. Neben Dimitra sitzt Elias. Elias Chronopoulos ist Partner von Refugee Support Aegean. Er unterstützt als Forscher das Rechtsanwaltsteam, das die Überlebenden von Pilos vor Gericht vertritt. Daneben sitzt Stavros. Stavros Malihoudis ist Chefredakteur der griechischen Investigativplattform Solomon. Auch er hat intensiv zu diesem Fall geforscht und viel dazu publiziert. Dafür hat Solomon ebenfalls den Daphne Caruana Galizia-Preis des Europäischen Parlaments 2023 erhalten und ebenfalls auch den zweiten Platz der Kategorie Migration des Europäischen Pressepreises, jetzt gerade. Okay, danke. Ich gebe weiter an dich, Dimitra.
Hi, thank you everyone. Thank you to you, Georg, and the Bundes for the invitation, and everyone who is here, and to the survivors that are here. I will speak about our research, and the research that Georg just mentioned is a joint investigation that we did together with Solomon. So we're going to divide parts of the work that we we're going to present, as well as The Guardian and IRD SDRGF. On 14 June 2023, the Adriana, a boat leaving Libya for Italy with hundreds of people on board, sank inside the Greek search and rescue zone in the Mediterranean Sea. This would become indeed one of the deadliest shipwrecks in the region of the last in recent history. Our digital reconstruction of this joint investigation of the boat's trajectory reveals significant inconsistencies in the Hellenic Coast Guard's account and indicates that indeed more than 600 people drowned as a result of actions undertaken by the HCG. In the hours following the shipwreck, conflicting accounts about the incident immediately began to circulate. The Hellenic Coast Guard denied responsibility, claiming that people on board resisted offers for assistance and that the boat capsized due to a sudden shift in weight. The survivors unanimously contest this account, blaming the HCG for multiple failed attempts to tow the boat, which ultimately destabilized it and led to its capsizing. The incident took place at night in international waters inside the Greek search and rescue zone, meaning Greece was indeed the coastal state responsible for initiating any search and rescue operations. The wreck now rests 5,000 meters under sea level in the Calypso Deep, the deepest point in the Mediterranean, rendering its retrieval impossible. The only witnesses to the shipwreck are the 104 survivors of the boat, some of whom are, of course, with us today, and the crew of a small open sea patrol vessel operated by the Hellenic Coast Guard, the so-called PPLS 920, which is the same vessel accused by the witnesses for the fatal towing. According to our analysis and the cross-referencing of data, there appeared to have been a series of efforts by the HCG to distort and manipulate evidence related to the incident, as well as silence witness accounts. Nearby commercial vessels that were initially summoned by the HCG to provide assistance were subsequently ordered to leave. Likewise, repeated offers by Frontex, the European Border and Coast Guard Agency, to deploy aerial surveillance assets were ignored, and none of the several cameras aboard. I'm sorry. several cameras on board of the patrol boat were not operating on that night, were not as required, and neither did the AIS system, the tracking system. Furthermore, all of the survivors of the wreck had their phones confiscated by members of the Hellenic Coast Guard. Some survivors that we interviewed mentioned that these phones, protected in waterproof cases, included videos that they took of moments leading up to the shipwreck and to the capsizing of the boat, meaning that they included significant visual documentation of what happened. The first testimonies from survivors gathered by the Hellenic Coast Guard the day after the incident display signs of possible manipulation as well, and I'm sure my colleagues will also speak more to that. Questions around the sink. Okay, yes. Okay, I'm sorry, I will do a bit slower, yes. At Forensis, we built an interactive cartographic platform that maps the itinerary of the boat from its point of departure on the eastern Libyan coast until the location where it sank inside the Greek search and rescue zone, which is in international territorial waters. Our map brings together different information sources, including distress signals shared by the vessel's passengers, videos and photographs of the boat taken by the HCG, by Frontex, and nearby commercial vessels, vessel tracking and flight path data, satellite imagery, as well as the logs and testimonies handed to the Greek authorities by the captain of the HCG vessel, which was present on the scene, and nearby commercial vessels. This data is cross-referenced with the testimonies of 26 survivors who were interviewed by our team of researchers and journalists. And we also used the same photographs and videos to produce 3D models of the boat and the HCG vessel 920, which we shared with the lawyers representing survivors to use in their gathering of testimony. We then used these models to conduct situated testimony interviews, which is a methodology of interviewing that we have developed at Forensic Architecture over the course of the past 15 years, which essentially uses the aid of digital models in order to support the process of interviewing and testimony. We used that methodology with five people, two men from Syria who were sitting on the top outer deck at the time of the capsizing, and three men from Pakistan who were sitting inside on the middle deck. With the help of these models, the survivors reconstructed the conditions on the boat and events that led to the sinking from their respective perspectives. Okay. Got it. Thank you. Sorry. We should have made the test of this, I guess. So now we wanted to present to you the timeline of how we reconstructed the incident through this interactive cartographic platform, which essentially is a timeline of the trajectory of the boat and the nearby vessels leading up to the capsizing. Here we see on the 9th of June, at approximately 7 Greek time, the boat leaves from the a cove east of Tobruk in the coast of Libya, heading to Italy. And we can also see the line of the boat here. At 10:35 on the 13th of June, so 4 days later, the activist Nawal Sufi tweets that the boat with around 750 people on board is in distress and without drinking water. At 10:43, this is the tweet that she makes, and at 10:43 she also shares the location of the boat with coordinates. At 11 a.m., a few minutes later, the Italian Search and Rescue Operations Center in Rome informs the Hellenic Joint Rescue Coordination Center, the JRCC, that there is a boat containing a large number of people in distress. At 12:47, so a couple of hours later, we have the first identification of the boat of Adriana by an aerial surveillance asset of Frontex, Eagle One, that spots the boat, and this is one of the images that was published. It's actually cropped, so you cannot see the metadata, but there is also metadata on the image. And it locates it within the Greek search and rescue zone. Frontex shares then information about the location, orientation, and condition of the boat with the Greek and Italian authorities. Next, at approximately 3:11 p.m., Nawal Sufi, the same activist, tweets again, and the updated coordinates of the boat and that 7 passengers have fainted. She reports that the Maltese, Italian, and Greek authorities have been informed, and reports suggest that the weather was mild with only 2 to 4 winds. Our mapping indicates that the boat was traveling between 2 and 4.5 knots. And survivors later stated that at this point, the boat was lost, zigzagging through the water, and had been attempting to orient themselves essentially by a single compass and the position of the sun. At approximately 1:50 p.m., it is the first action that we see undertaken by the Hellenic Coast Guard, where they send a helicopter from Mytilene to assess the situation. The helicopter arrives at 3:35 p.m. and locates the migrant boat and reports that it is sailing on a steady course and at a stable speed. The Hellenic Joint Rescue Coordination Center asks nearby commercial ships to provide assistance, and they also instruct a Hellenic Coast Guard vessel to sail from Crete, which is the number 920, to the scene, but they actually transmit the location of the migrant boat incorrectly. So you can see here in our map where the location that they transmitted is versus the actual location of the boat at that time. A couple of hours later, at 5:13 p.m., after several attempts to communicate with alarm phone, which is a hotline to support rescue operations, the passengers of the migrant boat managed to transmit their correct coordinates. So we can see here also the tweet of alarm phone, where they describe the course of events and how many times they communicate with the boat. Alarm phone relays these details to the Hellenic Coast Guard, to Frontex, to the headquarters of the Greek police, to the Ministry of Citizen Protection, to the Coast Guard of Kalamata, and to other authorities. At 5:48 p.m., the Joint Rescue Coordination Center notifies two nearby tankers, commercial ships, Lucky Sailor and the Faithful Warrior, asking them to approach the vessel to assess its status and provide it with food, water, and diesel. So we can see here also on our map the Lucky Sailor and Faithful Warrior approaching. At 6:35 p.m., the passengers of the boat call alarm phone again. They give updated position. They say that the boat is overcrowded and that it is leaning sideways. And at 6:55, Nawal Sufi, the same activist that originally reported on the first report about the boat, tweets again that passengers on board have died and others are in critical condition. Witness testimony later confirms that at least two Pakistani men died from dehydration before the capsizing. At around 7 p.m., starting at 6, another helicopter conducts a second flyover and it locates the boat at around 7 p.m. And 15 minutes later, it is when it is approached by Lucky Sailor, who at that point also post a video of them and the boat at close distance and attempts to provide it with supplies. So this is the first video that was taken by the Lucky Sailor. It is around that time, so at 7:40, where a European Space Agency satellite captures the boat next to the Lucky Sailor. So the Lucky Sailor is the longer white spot that we see here, and the migrant boat is next to it. At 8:15, so approximately an hour later, 45 minutes later, there is a second video that is filmed by the Lucky Sailor crew, showing supplies being transferred through. We can see the supplies here being transferred through by rope to the migrant boat. At 9:30, the Faithful Warrior also approaches the migrant boat, and we can see it here on our map. And in order to offer assistance, it is at approximately 9:45 where the captain of the Faithful Warrior informs the Joint Rescue Coordination Center that the distress boat is rocking dangerously from side to side. There was actually a video recorded by the Hellenic Coast Guard crew showing the migrant boat next to the faithful warrior, which confirms this. So this is not video, an actual recording of the camera. It is actually a video of someone from the crew filming the screen as it was recording at the time. Because as they said, there were actually no recordings of what happened. Now here there are some conflicting accounts between the logs that we examined, and it speaks again to conflicting information from the Hellenic Coast Guard accounts, because it is then that minutes later, after the faithful warrior reports that the boat was rocking dangerously, that they say that the Hellenic Coast Guard arrived. However, according to a press release by the Hellenic Coast Guard that was published after the incident, they say that the 920 vessel of the Hellenic Coast Guard arrived at 10:40, which again differs from the actual bridge logs of the Hellenic Coast Guard vessel. So here, it is approximately at 11:45, where according to the log of the Hellenic Coast Guard vessel, the vessel approaches the boat and communicates with the passengers and claim that the passengers declare that they want to continue to Italy. So it is when they claim that the assistance has been denied. As written in the bridge logs of the Hellenic Coast Guard vessel, at 11:57, so actually let me just go one step earlier, the migrant vessel starts moving westwards at a speed of approximately 3 knots. However, using the actual coordinates provided in the logs of the vessel, our analysis shows that its average speed is in fact 4.95 knots, contrary to the HCG claims that the migrant boat moved at its own initiative. Survivors have since testified that the HCG instructed them to follow their boat to Italian waters, and presumably so that the boat leaves the Greek search and rescue zone and they are handed to the Italian authorities. So we can see here this westward movement. The blue line is that of the Hellenic Coast Guard vessel, and the red line is that of the migrant boat. It is around half an hour past midnight that, according to the captain of Faithful Warrior, the Greek Joint Rescue Coordination Center releases Faithful Warrior, which leaves at, like I said, half hour past midnight. And earlier that night at 7:35, Frontex sources reveal that they offered to support the HCG by sending aerial surveillance assets to the scene again, and they repeat the offer at 34 minutes past midnight, but they had no response by the Hellenic Coast Guard. At 44 minutes past midnight, according to the coordinates noted by the Hellenic Coast Guard, the migrant boat turns south and reduces its speed to a near halt. This contradicts the description reported in the same log, which states that the boat continues westwards until 1:40 a.m. And it is at 1:40 a.m., which again, according to the log of the Hellenic Coast Guard, the engine of the boat stops. Survivors confirmed that the engine stops a few minutes before the boat capsized. At 2:06 a.m., the Hellenic Coast Guard vessel logs that the migrant boat is sinking 250 meters east of the location where the engine stopped, and all commercial boats in its proximity are called to assist. According to testimonies of multiple survivors, the HCG attempted to tow the migrant boat twice. The second attempt at towing caused the boat to capsize. Immediately after the capsizing, the HCG left the scene for approximately 20 to 30 minutes, causing waves upon its departure that further contributed to the sinking of the boat, and the HCG only returned after 30 minutes to start a rescue operation. Here we will watch 5 minutes of those situated testimonies that we conducted, where survivors essentially described that moment before the capsizing and the two attempts that were made to tow the boat by the Hellenic Coast Guard. Oh, no, actually I'm gonna...
This is the first time that they approached you.
First time
when I see together. Too close.
Yes.
Front. Yeah. So
too close.
Front side.
This week the followers and we are following, I think, 60 to 90. Then suddenly the ship was stopped.
طبعا أول شيء إجوا قالوا الحقونا. مشينا وراهم بالطول شي نص ساعة. بعدين المحرك ما عاد مشى. عرفت؟ وقف المحرك. قالوا بدنا نريح نص ساعة. حكوا وقالوا ليش وقفتوا؟
ولوين كانوا عم يقولوا لكم حقونا؟ ما كانوا
أساس يودونا لعند الخفر الإيطالي، أساس الخفر الإيطالي بستنانا أول مياه الإيطالية.
وبعدين؟
بعدين لما وقف القارب إجوا سحبونا وقفوا سحبونا على الجنب، ما سحبونا من قدام هيك.
كانوا على اليمين مع هيك لما سحبوكم؟
على اليمين. واحد منهم يعني مثل
نزل كيف نزل نط ولا
سبحان الله هم رجعوا اخر شيء صاروا لزق فيكم ايه بعدين بعدوا عنا ربطوا الحبل وبعدوا
شو كان لون المسكه هذا القناع
اسود الحبل الربط هون
حطوا سبعه اقرب زبطيت
اول شده انقطع الحبل
First time.
أول شد هنا كل الركاب راحوا على الناحية هاي قطع الحبل جل.
شايفين هنا الركاب بركين. تشيب مو فارور. سلم. مايكا راكن.
هم نفس رد رجعوا ربطوا ومكنوا وردوا سحبوا السحب الثاني بقوة. قالوا الحبل هيك صرنا نسعي عليهم نو 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 قربنا.
يعني شيء 100 متر؟
أقل وقت جرونا أقل من هيك
كان بسرعة ولا بطيء؟
لا بسرعة
حكيتوها وقتها أنت؟
ما صرنا نصيح عليهم صياح نو 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 وهم طبعا وإحنا قاعدين نقلب في واحد منهم واقف ولاد علينا يعني مش والله إنه في واحد منهم واقف من ورا ولاد علينا شلون قاعدين نقلب
First Second.
First from here.
First.
Then
second.
To there. And then.
Then. Full.
I sit. 50 minutes or 20 minutes I sit. This is. I sit. No.
Al-Akhir. I'm going to phone, get a pitch, not take the money, smash it like one home. Or phone back at one minute. بعدوا صاروا من ناحية هاي هون هون فتلوا هون فتلوا فتلة كبيرة سببوا موجة بالموجة هاي هيك كنا هيك صار
يعني طلع بوزو لهيك
صار مثل سفينة تايتن كيوم نزلت هون هو قاعد يقلب أنا نطيت بالمي نطيت لهون هيك صرت أسبح رايح لهون بدك تقول كانهم نزلوا القوارب واجوا يساعدونا بدك تقول اكثر من نص ساعه، نص ساعه اكثر شوي.
كان نص ساعه.
and soon to Coast Guard.
Do you want to show us how far?
Somewhere here?
I think.
Far.
Yes.
The ship was down to the sea.
Mm-hmm.
Then they are rescued the people.
Our ship
not
full into the water.
Mm-hmm.
Yunnan ship not came.
I lost my friends, my cousins, my brother-in-law.
I think I will stop here because I will hand it over to my colleagues to expand more on some of the things that I just mentioned.
Okay, change of plans, I will speak now. Thank you also, Georg and everyone, for organizing this event. Yeah, 1 year after this tragedy, it's a really difficult day for everyone, especially for the survivors, and that's why we are really thankful that they are today here, that they show the strength and they are willing to be present on the struggle for justice. On this struggle is where the solidarity has the duty to be next to it and not to substitute. I'm a partner of Refugee Support Aegean, as you know, and I'm working together with RSA lawyers and the lawyers from other collectives that are representing the survivors on the criminal complaint before the Naval Court of Piraeus. This tragedy is not just a tragedy, and it's not just, of course, an accident. It was exactly what I was going to say. Thank you. Yeah, this tragedy was actually a crime. Not a tragedy only, not just an accident, but a crime. And for this reason, 40 of the survivors last September, today they are 53, filed a criminal complaint at the Naval Court of Piraeus, as I said before, against any responsible party for the acts and omissions of the Greek authorities in relation to the Pylos shipwreck. The case is now in the preliminary investigation stage by the prosecutor, and it's underway. We will not have probably any updates till the end of the summer. So far, 23 witnesses, survivors, have already testified. The complaint calls for an investigation for the commission of felonies putting lives at risk, causing the shipwreck, and committing homicides, among other things. I want to remind you also that everything is uncertain on when and what at the end will come from this, that in the case of Farmakonisi, that we recently had a decision from the European Court of Human Rights that was condemning Greece for this shipwreck, it came after 11 years. It was a case, again, that we had a shipwreck that was caused by the Greek Coast Guard towing a migrant boat, which also the European Court of Human Rights condemned Greece for delaying the start of and conducting a proper search and rescue operation. I think that the scale of this crime is so big, and the strength to fight for justice is also so big that we have in front of us still many things to do and to see. A complaint is expected to be filed also by relatives of the victims. Probably also more survivors will join the criminal complaint in the next weeks. There are many concerns, serious concerns and questions for the preservation of evidence and proof, considering the absence of information from the Coast Guard, and also serious shortcomings regarding substantial evidence that should have been available since the beginning. I want to say here some of the strange coincidences that so many coincidences always can create a concern for a cover-up. As Dimitri also said before, the cameras of the vessel 920 were not recording on this day because the recording system was not working, which is strange. The Coast Guard ignored three offers from Frontex to join the operation. From Frontex aircrafts, we would have had more footage, but we don't have. Okay. In other operations, this specific vessel that was on scene, the Coast Guard vessel 920, was using head cameras, but on this they didn't have head cameras also. We have the smartphones of the survivors, as Dimitra also mentioned before, that they were lost for a month and they were found in a plastic bag inside vessel 920 and allegedly completely damaged. But even the requests from the lawyers of the nine that I will say a bit more later to examine them were rejected. The smartphones of the crew were confiscated, of the crew of the vessel 920 of the Coast Guard were confiscated 3 months after the shipwreck, a lot of time after the events. And also, the most recent update, which is adding another weird coincidence, is that the VDR, the voyage data recorders of the Coast Guard vessel 920, something like the equivalent of the black box, but for ship, was also not working since 2022 for this vessel, and it was only repaired in August 2023, so 2 months after the shipwreck. With this, with the VDR, we would have data and information about what happened on this night, very specifically, but it's another thing that we should have, but we don't have. I would like also to say, I don't know if this is what it was mentioned before, but 25 of the survivors have also filed a complaint before the Office of the Fundamental Rights Office of Frontex against officials and staff of Frontex for violations of fundamental rights due also to their acts and omissions. And there are many moments that it was also Frontex duty to call to issue a Mayday relay and call for a search and rescue operation, but they didn't do it. There are from the timeline that Dimitra just presented, there are six very specific moments that at least on these six moments, it should have been initiated a search and rescue operation from the Greek Coast Guard or from the Frontex, but it didn't happen. I will try to briefly say these six moments. The one is at 11 o'clock when the Italian authorities notify the Greek Coast Guard and Frontex that there is an overcrowded vessel with around 750 people on board with reports for two dead kids on board, it is already a reason to start a search and rescue operation. And we don't have any reaction from the Greek side. The Frontex aircraft that goes there goes at around 1 o'clock, 12:47 p.m., sends footage and the location and other details to the Greek authorities. This is the second moment that it's very clear that it's overcrowded, that it's not capable of reaching on its destination, and still we don't have the Mayday relay. The third moment, this is 13 hours before the shipwreck, and the first one was 15 hours before the shipwreck. I want to point that this is plenty of time to conduct a proper search and rescue operation and to avoid losing even one life. It is something that it was totally possible. The Greek authorities, even at this moment, they keep stalling, they keep wasting time, and they sent only 2 hours after, at around 2 o'clock, 1:50, I think, a helicopter from the other side of Greece, from Lesvos, to go and get footage and locate the vessel. Although they had already the coordinates, they had also the coordinates of the satellite phone on board, they had already aerial footage, and this was totally a move to spend more time. And only then, when the helicopter locates the vessel, at 3:30, they decide to mobilize the first floating asset towards Adriana. We are 4.5 hours after the initial call from the Italian authorities. There is still plenty of time, but they choose to send a vessel which is not suitable for rescue. They send a border patrol vessel, a vessel which is equipped with only 50 life jackets, while they know that it has 750 people on board, and also it's obvious that they don't have any means of rescue. It's also, I think, from the Italian authorities noted, but it's obvious from all the images that they have that they don't have rescue means. And they go with 50 vessels for 750 people, with 50 life jackets. The vessel that they mobilize comes not from the nearest port authorities of Pylos, which was 47 to 50 nautical miles, Gythio, Kalamata, but it comes from Crete, almost 3 times longer distance than Pylos, even more than 3. So it's obvious that Greece is not treating this incident as an incident. This operation is not treated as an operation of search and rescue. It's still a border surveillance operation for the Greek side. 8 hours before the shipwreck, alarm phone sends an email with an SOS saying that they are in distress and they are urgently asking for help. This is the fourth moment which is clear that they should have started a search and rescue operation and they didn't do it. Here, Frontex received also the email, replied to the email, but they didn't take any action also. 4 hours before the shipwreck, we have the video when Adriana is next to Faithful Warrior, this huge tanker which is rocking dangerously, according even to the captain of Faithful Warrior, which is recorded from the crew of the Coast Guard vessel. So they are there, they see it, they record it, they send it to the Joint Coordination Rescue Center, and they do nothing again. And still we have time before the capsizing. Still we have hours before the capsizing where we could have had a totally different story to say today. At around 12:30, the Greek Coast Guard dismisses Faithful Warrior, so it stays the only vessel next to Adriana, which is a vessel which doesn't have the means or even the space to help the people that they are in distress. 26 minutes before the shipwreck, at 1:40, the captain of 920 Coast Guard vessel says that we are preparing a rescue operation because Adriana stopped moving. Even on this moment, which is we have already wasted 15 hours, 26 minutes before the shipwreck, we don't know what was this preparation, what they did. They didn't issue a mayday relay. They didn't put down any floating boats. They didn't provide any life jackets. They didn't do anything. The only moment that the Greek Coast Guard starts a search and rescue operation is after the capsizing. And in fact, Magian Queen, the yacht that collected all of the survivors, got the order to go to help at 2:30, so 24 minutes after the shipwreck. Even 1 minute, it's really critical in these moments. 24 minutes are really a problem. And of course, then we have the towing that all the testimonies of the survivors claim that it was this that caused it, the capsizing. That in the beginning, the Greek Coast Guard was claiming that there was not even a rope thrown from the Coast Guard vessel to Adriana. And when all the survivors were giving testimony saying they had to change it, and they admitted it that they threw a rope, but they didn't admit of the towing. I want to say also that this is not the first time that we have a towing from the Greek Coast Guard. As I said before, also in the Pharmakonisi case, the Greek Coast Guard had towed the migrant vessel, and on this case they admitted it, they confessed that they did it. It's a practice that it's been even advertised from the Greek Coast Guard in other rescue operations which is a dangerous practice because they are not the proper vessels to do it, and they put even fishing trawlers to do it sometimes on migrant vessels, exactly because some lives don't count on the same way like others. One painful thing is that after the big original crime of this day, many more crimes followed. One crime was that 9 of the survivors, after they had been through all this, they were picked up and accused as smugglers, the ones that caused the shipwreck, with a very problematic procedure, without even certified translators on the first testimonies, and I think that on this you will add also some more things. And these 9 people stayed in prison for 11 months until a few days ago, on the 21st of May, when their trial was finally, when in a few hours the court decided to drop the charges and they were free from the charges, not free totally because they stayed in detention, all of them in the beginning. At the moment, only one is still detained in an administrative detention. But these people, because of the normality of the criminalization of refugees that in Greece and Europe takes place, and because it was convenient to create a different narrative on what happened on this day, they suddenly saw their faces all over the media as the ones that caused even the shipwreck. They stayed in prison for 11 months, and now, even if they are free, justice is lost. We said also that 104 people survived from the shipwreck. 84 dead bodies were found. From them, 8 still remain unidentified. 18 bodies out of the 84 are unburied till today. 10 because they are not identified, 8 because they are identified, and 10 because of lack of money to bury them. There are efforts at the moment that the Greek state will cover the costs and at least this moment of dignity and closure can come for the families of the dead. And of course, with the missing people, there the things are even more complicated. The process to even issue a certificate for the missing people hasn't even started yet. After the DVI finishes with the identifications, we are expecting from the Court of Kalamata to take over on this process, and then we will have probably some news. Another crime is how the survivors, the 104 survivors, apart from the 9 also, were treated after the rescue. They were put in a warehouse in Kalamata, not in proper conditions, not receiving the psychosocial support that was necessary for victims of shipwreck. Then they would transfer to Malakasa, many of them without even receiving clothes or basic things. The asylum interviews started for some of them really fast track without even having lawyers. Till today, there are still people that they are waiting for their asylum applications. They are in a limbo. There are 2 that their asylum application was rejected even. They are not treated as victims and survivors of a tragic event, and also as witnesses of a crime, but they are treated again on the same racist way that immigrants and refugees are treated in Greece and in Europe. There are other investigations also from the Greek Ombudsman and the European Ombudsman. I don't know now if we have the time to say more or better we try to close it. Just want to say that this crime has the people who were responsible of the actions and omissions that they did and what they didn't do on this day. And it has also the responsibility on the European and Greek policies, the policies of deterrence, the policies of the borders, that they are leading hundreds of people in death and in dignified conditions. So it is our duty to fight for justice for Pylos in the court, in the criminal complaint, but it's also our duty to fight for a different migration policy in Greece, in Germany, in Europe. Thank you very much.
Hello, from me also. Thank you very much for the patience, Georg and everybody. Thank you to the foundations and organizations for the hospitality, as always. And I want to say to my friends here that I'm very sorry that your first probably interaction with Greece was in that way, and I hope that life here is treating you better than what you experienced in my country. My name is Stavros Malichoudis and I'm a reporter at Solomon. Solomon is an outlet where we cover migration. It was created by Greeks and migrants, so it has very much this profile and we want to keep it this way. And what I will talk about is based on this research we published today. This is a podcast for anybody who is interested, which follows stories on what happened 1 year on. And this one is the story we worked together with Forensis, ARD, and The Guardian. So basically, what I will share is based mostly on this work that we have done over the one past year. I would say that for us, everything started when we learned about this email. This is the email from alarm phone informing the Greek, Italian, European authorities about Adriana, about this boat. Back then, I would just like to remind that there was a big argument by people who were close to the government, which said that this is not a proper way of asking for help, so why should we help them? And I think that, like, I think basic human understanding is that when someone is asking for help, it's a basic human, you know, I don't know, dignity to not look at the ways that if it doesn't fit the paperwork or the bureaucracy or the proper conditions, but when someone is asking for help, this comes first. Of course, later through our research, also with Forensis, we realized that this was not the only way that people aboard had asked for help, but everybody, the Greek authorities, Frontex, the Italian authorities, they were very, very well informed, and they had also visual knowledge of how things were on board. Okay, I would like to say that when this alert happened, when this emergency happened, everything seemed to be in the best conditions possible. The boat that was sent on spot, that my colleagues talked about, this LS920, it is one of the best equipped vessels that Greece has. When we researched, we realized that these, along with three other vessels, were bought in 2021. So it's quite new, super new. For Greek standards, it's very new. And they were bought the four boats were bought for more than 40 million euros from an Italian company. So this is supposed to be one of the top and best equipped Coast Guard vessels that Greece has. This is how it's a video on the day that we received it from Italy, and people are celebrating, and here you cannot see, but this ship on the left, it's throwing water to celebrate. And this is how it looks in the inside. So as I said, it's a state-of-the-art, very new, very well-equipped boat that was sent there. As we saw in the investigation, it also has some well-equipped cameras which would be able to record everything. One thing that we should take in mind is that we have already discussed that the cameras were not working. One thing that we discovered through our investigation with forensics and the others was that Greece had an order to do record visually the operations. And this happened because Greece, before, the Greek Coast Guard, had been caught abusing human rights. So in a Frontex meeting, in a meeting of the European Border Agency, other countries said that because Greece has this bad record, this bad history, it should document all the actions because, very simply said, we don't trust that it does what it should. So I want to highlight that it's not only that the cameras were not working, it's not only that the cameras were of a Coast Guard vessel which was bought just 3 years ago, a very new, a very well-equipped vessel, but it's also that Greece had the orders to do document investigations because of the history in human rights abuses. This is also confirmed. We searched for some articles by magazines which cover, maritime sector, and there they also mention that all communications that the JRCC they do have, they do collect. You know, like one when the shipwreck happened, they said that there was no also the communications between the vessel and the and the center of control of the Coast Guard, that these were not available. We saw in other articles that they always do keep a record because, of course, as it said here, they might need them for judicial authorities as evidence. This is common knowledge, but again, the information we have is that there is no communication, official communication, between the Coast Guard vessel and the headquarters, but instead that they were talking instead of the official procedure with mobile phones. And the last thing that I want to mention about how good things could be when this emergency happened is that the Coast Guard vessel captain in this ceremony that took place in March 2023, he was awarded for his service. So basically you have a great vessel, very well equipped, driven by an awarded captain who didn't follow the basic instructions. When we worked on this investigation, back then it was still not clear whether there was a towing, actually whether there was a rope at all. The Greek authorities for the first 2 days, they never mentioned, they never accepted that the rope was used at any time of the operation. When they were pressured by the journalists, especially in TV, they did acknowledge that there was a rope, but that the rope was used just to get closer to the boat, so that the two boats would come closer. The survivors we interviewed, who were more than 20 for the joint investigation we did together, many of them, they did talk of a rope, and some of them, they talked of a blue rope. When we searched into, what kind of photos we could find from this vessel, we could see, and you can see the photos are not ideal, but you can see that the specific vessel uses a blue rope, indeed. And indeed, my colleague Stefanos Levidis, who works at Forensis, this year, so after the shipwreck, in March 2024, when he was in Lesbos, he documented the same Coast Guard vessel using a blue rope. And these are some photos just which can show it better. These photos are after the shipwreck in 2024, March. When we publish the investigation and the official response, and the response that we get always when we report on human rights abuses by the Coast Guard, is that the Greek Coast Guard saves lives. This is the response we get to whatever the question is. And this is actually true, and this is because we see it here in the YouTube page of the Coast Guard. So I mean that the Coast Guard, when there are operations that it feels content about, they do make videos and they do publish stuff. So I think that this should also pose one more alarming thought to ourselves, into the sense of like, why is there no video at all of that night? One question that we had to confront when we worked on this investigation was if it could be possible that the Greek Coast Guard would do something like that. Like, could it be possible that the Greek Coast Guard tows boats? Could it be possible that the Greek Coast Guard tries to bring boats from one place to another? Because in the case of Adriana, the understanding we have is that it tried to bring the boat from the Greek waters to the Italian waters and just let it there so that it wouldn't be a problem of Greece anymore, but of Italy. To research this question, we went into an OLAF investigation. OLAF is an official body of the EU, so it's not Georg, it's not Stavros, it's not Ilias, it's an official body. And OLAF did an investigation where they basically entered the headquarters of Frontex in Warsaw, and they took laptops, mobile phones, and they checked the internal communications. So everything in this investigation was not based in what we said or any survivor said, but it was based in the internal communications unfiltered. In this report that you can find online, there are several instances where Frontex helicopters or drones, they do witness the Greek Coast Guard towing boats. And especially this happens in the Aegean Sea with boats coming from Turkey to the Greek islands. So the answer to the question if the Greek Coast Guard would be capable of doing that is unfortunately yes. One thing that has been mentioned already is that the Greek Coast Guard on that night seems to have sent away any nearby ships. One argument on this is that if it wanted to do a pushback or bring the boat to Italy, there would be no witnesses. Frontex, in the internal communications, they do document several of such cases, as documented in the OLAF report. Okay, one aspect that we talk about is the Greek responsibility. It has been well researched, well covered. We talk about it. One thing that we should take in mind is that all this, it happens in a European context, and this is not a country acting on its own, but it's a whole system that enables it. When the shipwreck happened, there were several EU officials in high positions that expressed how sad they were about it. Their grief, you know, this couldn't happen in Europe, we should have helped these people. So there was lots of grief on that day from the higher EU ranks. What we realized is that, actually I will show this first. When we checked the budget given to Greece for 2021 to 2027, we realized that Greece gets more than 800 million euros from the European Union for border management, but just 0.07% of this is about search and rescue. So this is like not even 1% of the money. The bigger chunk of this money goes to things like this, to high-speed patrol boats, to vessels, to things like this, to drones, to ground equipment, and to things like this. more fences and more cars and more vehicles. When we asked officials after the shipwreck if anything could happen differently, like one side is feeling sorry about it and feeling sad about it and expressing your grief. On the practical side, what could happen about it? The reply we got is that practically, the EU doesn't have the opportunity to fund search and rescue operations. Like there's no budget about this, there's no specific code, it's out of their mandate. Apparently the EU can give 800 million euros to Greece, but mostly for this kind of things. I don't want to take longer because I was already late, but what I wanted to say is that, of course, what we need 1 year from this now is this kind of justice that the survivors talk about. And I want to say that besides all the operational reasons and anything that could have happened that night, personally what I have in mind is a survivor from Egypt who in one panel, like this one discussion, he said that when people fell in the water, he was always he could hear a girl screaming in the water, and that at some point he couldn't hear the girl anymore. As far as we know, there are no girls that survived. And for me, one big question that has to be answered is, as Ilya said, why from the moment, if we forget everything that happened, and we just have to ask why from the moment the boat capsized, the Greek Coast Guard waited almost half an hour to start helping people. And I think that this is a question that should be addressed to authorities. We try to address this question to authorities, but as Georg said before, like in a rule of law country, this question should be answered, but we have no success on that at all. There has been no accountability. The Coast Guard has not had to answer at all. The captain has not had to answer. And I think that these questions, yes, they should be answered sometime. Thank you.
Jetzt freue ich mich sehr darauf, von Ibrahim Al-Absi und Amar Abada zwei Reden zu hören, zwei von den Überlebenden, die sich heute bereit erklärt haben, hier zu kommen. Dafür müssen wir jetzt, we have to change seats now. No, please stay on the top here, but go to the sides, so that we need four seats in the middle for the two survivors, for Tarek Alois and for Nadine. So I'll step down. Could you please come up? Okay.
مساء الخير. بالحقيقة هذا الشيء اللي عم بتشوفوه. نحن من تاريخ 14/6 إلى هاي اللحظة ونحن كل هذا الشيء بشكل يومي عم نعيشه بسبب كان إنا أقارب وأصدقاء وكل شخص من الناجين الموجودين هون إله صديق أخ ابن عم فكلياتنا دائما متذكر هاي المعاناة كلياتها وبشكركم على الاستماع وبتاريخ 9/6/2023 انطلقت السفينة في رحلة البحث عن الأمان بسبب الظلم الذي يقع على الحدود الأوروبية خسرنا ما يزيد عن 600 شخص لقد كانت الرحلة عبارة عن متاعب وشعور بالخوف حيث أن السفينة كانت ومنذ البداية متهالكة لكن لا يمكننا العودة بعد ذلك بسبب إجرام تجار البشر بدأ الإبحار دون مشاكل ولكن في بداية اليوم الثالث من الرحلة نفذ الطعام والشراب لدينا ولم يتبقى لدينا أي حلول إلا أن نصل بخير وسلام لكن استمرت المعاناة ليومين آخرين في اليوم الخامس والأخير لهذه الرحلة المأساوية قمنا بطلب الإنقاذ قبل 15 ساعة من الغرق لكن وطيلة هذه الوقت لم يكن هناك أي استجابة من قبل السلطات اليونانية وحرس الحدود الأوروبية فرونتكس. لقد اكتفوا بإرسال سفينتين تجاريتين لإعطائنا القليل من الماء، لكن كانت تلك السفينتين بمثابة الموت لنا بالنسبة لنا، لأن ليس هناك شخص عاقل يعطي 100 لتر من الماء ل 750 شخص يعانون من الجوع والعطش منذ يومين. في هذه الأوقات طلبنا من الطاقم السفينة التجارية أن تقوم بحملنا معها لأننا نحتاج للوصول إلى بر الأمان. فمن المعروف أننا فقدنا طريقنا في البحر، وحسب قانون الاتحاد الأوروبي فمن الواجب أن تنقذ من يكون في محنة في البحر، لكن خفر السواحل اليونانية ومنظمة فرونتكس تجاهلت تلك القوانين وتركتنا لمصيرنا.
مرحبا. بعد تلك الأحداث أتت سفينة خفر السواحل وقامت بسحبنا ومن ثم انقلب القارب نتيجة لأفعالهم. لقد تجاهل خفر السواحل اليوناني أرواح المهاجرين على متن السفينة، وقاموا بعملية سحب استهتارية دون أن يأخذوا بعين الاعتبار أي إجراء سلامة. لم يقوموا بإعطائنا أي سترة نجاة، ولم يكونوا مهيئين للتعامل مع الحالات الحرجة، لأننا وبطبيعة الحال لدينا أشخاص ماتوا قبل الغرق نتيجة الجوع والعطش والظروف السيئة على متن السفينة. للأسف وبعد أن غرقنا ظننا أن السفينة خفر السواحل اليونانية ستساعدنا، ولكن أصبنا بالصدمة بعد أن تحركت وقامت بالهروب. بعيداً عنا، لم يكن لدينا أي سبيل بعد ذلك لإنقاذ أنفسنا. لقد اضطررنا للسباحة لمسافات طويلة للوصول إلى سفينة خفر السواحل اليونانية، لقد وصلنا، ولكن هناك الكثير ممن لم يستطيع الوصول، فخسرنا نتيجة لهذه الأفعال كل تلك الأرواح البريئة.
Ich glaube, wir würden nachher mit den beiden Überlebenden eine Fragerunde machen. Mein Name ist Sarik Laus, bin flüchtlingspolitischer Sprecher vom Pro Asyl. Heute ist ein Tag der Trauer. Der Trauer und des Muts. Eine Trauer, weil wir heute 600 Menschen oder über 600 Menschen gedenken müssen, die nicht sterben hätten müssen, die man hätte retten können, die aber Europa sterben gelassen hat. Wir sprechen aber hier nicht über eine Zahl, nicht über 600 oder 650. Das sind Väter, Mutter, das sind Geschwister, das sind Kinder, das sind Menschen, haben ihre individuellen Geschichten, haben ihre individuellen Schicksale und haben auch Familie. In den letzten Tagen war ich mit den Überlebenden unterwegs. Und ich habe mich an meinem letzten Treffen mit ihnen in Frankfurt vor einem Monat erinnert an eine Geschichte von Mohammed zum Beispiel, der mir erzählte, wie er, als er in das Wasser gefallen ist mit seinem Bruder, die Hand seines Bruders die ganze Zeit genommen hat, damit er ihn nicht verliert. Aber unter dem Wasser musste er die Hand seines Bruders einfach fallen lassen oder er alleine lassen, weil er dachte, mein Bruder trägt einen Rettungsring und er könnte einfach sich retten. Vielleicht kommt er an die Oberfläche, Vielleicht sterbe ich, weil ich keinen Rettungsring habe. Dann soll ich alleine sterben und nicht meinen Bruder mitziehen. Jedoch Mohammed konnte schwimmen. Der hat es überlebt und er hat die Leiche seines Bruders bisher noch nicht gefunden. Und trotz all dieser Schmerz sind diese Menschen unterwegs mit all ihrer Stärke, mit all ihrem Mut, fordern die Gerechtigkeit, die Rechenschaft von den Zuständigen. Aber auf der anderen Seite stehen auf die Beine und fordern das nicht nur für sich selbst, sondern für uns, weil eine Demokratie lebt davon, dass Betroffene Gerechtigkeit bekommen. Mit ihrer Forderung verteidigen sie unsere Demokratie. Und das verdient nicht nur unsere Hochachtung und Respekt, sondern auch unsere Solidarität, praktische Solidarität und praktische Support. Deswegen stehen wir vom Pro Asyl auf der Seite der Menschen. Ab der ersten Minute mit unserer Partnerorganisation RSA in Griechenland, aber auch hier in Deutschland. Denn der Kampf hat dort angefangen, ist aber damit nicht beendet. Die Gerechtigkeit für die Menschen bedeutet nicht nur die Verurteilung der Zuständigen, sondern bedeutet auch bessere Zustände für sie hier in Deutschland. Wir haben ab der ersten Minute daran gearbeitet, dass mindestens Menschen, die Familienangehörige hier in Deutschland haben, in Deutschland aufgenommen würden, weil es nicht sein kann, dass ein Land, die von Menschen angeklagt wird, zuständig für die Durchführung ihrer Asylverfahren sein kann. Gerechtigkeit für die Menschen bedeutet auch die Herausgabe von den 18 Leichen, die immer noch ein Jahr nach diesem Verbrechen bei der griechischen Behörden liegen, mit der Argumentation, dass sie kein Geld haben, um das selbst zu bestatten als Stadt. Gerechtigkeit bedeutet, die Leichen aus dem Meer auszuziehen, damit die Menschen würdig bestattet werden könnten, damit die Familienangehörige das machen können. Wir sind in der Zivilgesellschaft immer daran gewöhnt, staatliche Aufgaben zu übernehmen. Also ich meine, ohne die Zivilgesellschaft wurde niemandem im Mittelmeer gerettet, und zwar seit Jahren. Ohne die Zivilgesellschaft hätte man niemanden aus Afghanistan evakuiert. Und auch ist das auch eine Aufgabe, die wir übernehmen wollen vom Pro Asyl. Wir würden diese Aufgabe übernehmen und uns darum kümmern, dass die 18 Leichen herausgegeben wurden und dass die menschenwürdig bestattet können. Wir arbeiten auch mit den Überlebenden hier vor Ort. Viele von ihnen haben bisher kein abgeschlossenes Asylverfahren. Ich meine, man braucht nur einen Blick in der Akte dieser Menschen als deutsche Behörde, um wissen zu können, das sind Menschen, die ein traumatisches Erlebnis überlebt haben, dass sie besondere Rechte im Asylverfahren, dass zumindest bei der Registrierung von ihnen in Deutschland angeboten wird, dass sie besondere medizinische Behandlung bekommen, dass sie therapeutische Unterstützung bekommen. Das hat man überhaupt hier nicht berücksichtigt in Deutschland. Viele von ihnen hängen immer noch mit einem unsicheren Status im Asylverfahren und wissen nicht, ob sie überhaupt eine Aufenthaltserlaubnis in Deutschland bekommen können oder nicht. Viele von ihnen haben gesagt, dass ihre Familienangehörige in beispielsweise Köln leben. Sie würden irgendwo anders auf der anderen Seite von Deutschland umverteilt, mussten in Erstaufnahmeeinrichtungen außerhalb von Städten leben. In einer Zeit, in der sie jegliche soziale Unterstützung von ihren Familienangehörigen brauchen. Deswegen Gerechtigkeit bedeutet auch menschenwürdige Aufnahme für die Überlebende auch hier in Deutschland, und dafür setzen wir uns ein. Es hat nicht beendet in Griechenland, sondern es bis zum heutigen Tag erleben wir einen Skandal nach dem anderen mit dem Umgang mit den Überlebenden. Und ich kann auch ganz klar sagen, wenn man einfach in den letzten 10 Jahren sieht, was an den Grenzen Europas passierte, dann wird man ganz klar wissen, dass das Verbrechen vor der griechischen Küste, vor Pylos, zwar für sich steht, aber eher für ein System steht. Ein System, wie man mit geflüchteten Menschen umgeht und umgegangen hat. Und genau dieses System müssen wir beenden, denn Gerechtigkeit bedeutet auch, dass solche Vorfälle aufhören, dass sie sich nicht mehr wiederholen. Und das braucht jede Stimme von der Zivilgesellschaft, die mit uns diesen Kampf eingeht und die den Menschen unterstützt in ihrem Weg zur Gerechtigkeit. Dankeschön. Ich würde sagen, also ich weiß nicht, ob ich ab jetzt die Moderation übernehme, Georg. Ah, ich übernehme. Okay. Okay. Dann würde ich gerne ein bisschen die Fragen an die Überlebenden moderieren. Ihr könnt gerne Fragen stellen. Gemeinsam mit meiner Kollegin Nadine, natürlich. Es gibt dort hinten eine Frage.
Dankeschön. Bitte. Ja, okay. Ja, ich wollte nur sagen, mich erschüttert das Ganze sehr. Es ist unglaublich, in was für einem reichen Land wir leben, was mitverantwortlich ist für das, was in den EU-Bestimmungen und Gesetzen gegen Geflüchtete an der Grenzabschottung passiert ist. Das ist ja jetzt, glaube ich, noch schlimmer geworden. Und die Leute sollen ja noch nicht mal mehr in Europa Asylanträge stellen, sondern man will ja durchsetzen, dass die irgendwo in Afrika oder irgendwo gestellt werden, dass die Menschen, um die Menschen zu demotivieren, zu flüchten, was völliger Unsinn ist, weil die flüchten ja nicht, um hier Sozialhilfe zu kriegen. Das sind alles Lügen, die aber in diesen Parteien von Deutschland immer wieder verbreitet werden. Und das macht mich so sprachlos und so wütend auch, dass ich das sehr gut finde, dass ihr mal hier auch seid. Und ich würde gerne fragen, wie können wir zusammen gegen diese nicht gegen diese fehlende Gerechtigkeit. Wie können wir zusammen dagegen aufstehen und mehr werden?
Dann Lecky, أتمنى أن تتحقق العدالة في الاتحاد الأوروبي. كما نعلم القانون وحقوق اللاجئين متاحة، فنحن طلعنا من بلدنا هربا من الظلم والبطش والعصابات التي تحكم هذه الدولة التي نعيش فيها، فقدمنا ما كان إن أي طريق سوى أن نطلع عن طريق البحر، لكن للأسف الشديد طلعنا الخفر السواحل اليوناني، والخفر السواحل اليوناني مارس هذا الشيء علينا وعلى كتير ناس، وتعرضت كتير ناس كمان لنفس الشيء ولنفس الغرق، وكانوا شهود، وللأسف أنا كمان شاهد على هذا الشيء. شفت أطفال، شفت طفل يبلغ من العمر من 12 لل 14 سنة قدام عيني وهو عم يغرق، أنا واقف عم بسمع وهو عم يطلب النجدة، بس أنا ما فيني أعمل له أي شيء. لكن للأسف الشديد انا بس عم بسمع عم بعطي دانه له فبسمع صوت المي وهي عم بتفوت على تمه هون اختفى حسه فهون عرفت انه مات فما كل مين كان بس بده يبعد عن الثاني لننقذ حالنا وتمينا واقفين بالمي يعني ما كان في عنا اي امل انه خفر اليوناني انقذنا لانه تسبب باغراقنا وبتمنى انه تتحقق العداله وان شاء الله نحن راح نتم نكفين ونتابع لحتى يتحاسب الخفر اليوناني على الشيء اللي سببوه لنا ولغيرنا وبتمنى انه ما يصير مع الناس اللي عم تجي هذا الشيء انه يقوموا باغراقهم لانه كل شخص إيلو أهل إيلو ناس كل شخص متجوز نحن ما لنا أرقام نحن بشر هربانين من الظلم جينا لهون لنلتجي ولنكون تحت القانون ولنبني مستقبل أفضل شكرا لكم
Ich habe eine Frage an euch. Wo und wie lebt ihr jetzt?
Also ich meine, die Frage können nicht alle beantworten gerade, aber ich kann auch sagen, weil wir die Verfahren von den Menschen in Deutschland auch mitbegleiten, die überlebenden Personen in Deutschland und natürlich mit denen wir im Kontakt stehen, sind in unterschiedlichen Städten, in mehreren Städten in Deutschland untergebracht. Viele von ihnen leben immer noch in Erstaufnahmeeinrichtungen unter einer Wohnverpflichtung. Sie würden nicht, also diese Verpflichtung könnte von den Behörden aufgegeben werden, in so einem besonderen Fall, aber das wurde nicht gemacht. Die Umstände sind total unterschiedlich, aber ich kann auch berichten, viele von den Überlebenden wohnen immer noch in Gemeinschaftsunterkünften unter sehr schlimmen Umständen, wo man keine Traumatisierung zum Beispiel heilen kann, wo es keine Privatsphäre gibt. Und natürlich sind wir nicht im Kontakt mit allen Menschen, die hier in Deutschland gekommen sind, aber zumindest mit den Menschen, mit denen wir im Kontakt sind, haben wir diese Informationen und dagegen würden wir oder kämpfen wir mit unserem Beratungsteam, um die Situation der Menschen in Deutschland hier zumindest zu verbessern an dieser Stelle, nach diesen ganzen Verbrechen und Skandale, die die EU und die EU-Politik mit ihnen gemacht hat.
Ja, vielen Dank für eure Berichte. Ich würde gerne wissen, wie der griechische Staat und die griechische Öffentlichkeit, die Presse, auf eure Anklage, auf die Anklage reagiert hat. Ich weiß zum Beispiel, dass ihr Veranstaltungen in Griechenland beim Verein der Archäologen durchgeführt habt und dass dem Verein der Archäologen das Haus entzogen worden ist auf diese Veranstaltung hin, auf diese Öffentlichkeit. Wie sieht es da in Griechenland aus? Das würde mich interessieren. Vielleicht auch an die Journalisten aus Griechenland. Vielleicht können die noch was dazu sagen.
Ich würde gerne die Frage nach hinten verschieben, weil gerade die Zeit für die Fragen für die Überlebende, ich meine, sie sitzen hier, man kann sie Fragen stellen und sie sollen ihre Zeit auch ein bisschen nehmen, um die Fragen zu beantworten und selbst zu berichten. Aber gerne dann im Nachhinein können die Kolleginnen dann nochmal berichten oder die Frage beantworten. Deswegen meine Frage wäre, gibt es noch weitere Fragen an die Überlebenden?
Ich hatte vorhin auch im Kopf zu fragen, was schon da war, wie die Überlebenden jetzt in welchem Land und unter welchen Bedingungen sind und auch Hilfe bekommen. Und das wurde ja schon geantwortet, jetzt die konkretere Frage, wie viele sind denn noch in Griechenland und wie geht es Ihnen speziell in Griechenland, auch in der Umgebung und in der Wahrnehmung der Bevölkerung?
Elias vielleicht kann besser beantworten, tatsächlich. Elias kann die Frage besser beantworten, aber das würde ich dann gerne verschieben. Unser Kollege Elias von RSA wird die Frage dann im Nachhinein beantworten. Ja.
Ich würde euch gerne fragen, ob ihr schon Reaktionen von hiesigen politischen Stellen bekommen habt. Ich sehe, wir sind alles hier, hier sind keine Politiker, glaube ich, außer Rosa-Luxemburg-Stiftung. Aber was ist mit der deutschen Politik, die ja mit dafür sorgt, dass im Mittelmeer die Menschen nicht ankommen, sondern ertrinken? Gibt es da Reaktionen von Politikern und Politikerinnen, die sagen, wir sind solidarisch und wir kommen vielleicht auch zu dieser Veranstaltung mit euch und wir möchten unsere Solidarität ausdrücken? Gibt es das?
Ich wiederhole die Frage auf Arabisch noch einmal.
أكيد كان في بعض السياسيين اللي تواصلوا معنا واللي كانوا واقفين معنا من أجل نأخذ العدالة من اللي خفر سواحل اليونان وإلى الآن لحد الآن يعني إنه واقفين معنا لأجل العدالة من خفر سواحل اليونان.
Also ganz konkret hatten die Überlebenden die erste Gelegenheit, mit deutschen PolitikerInnen zu sprechen, war vorgestern im Bundestag und tatsächlich auf eine Anfrage von Pro Asyl. Da waren 4 Abgeordnete und wir waren ungefähr für 2,5 Stunden mit den Überlebenden drin. Sie haben berichtet und ich war selbst schockiert ein bisschen, dass selbst in diesen politischen Kreisen das Thema noch nicht so ganz klar in ihrer Dimension angekommen ist, dass die PolitikerInnen überrascht waren von den Berichten, die die Überlebenden erzählt haben. Also so weit entfernt ist die deutsche Politik von den Realitäten der Menschen, die zu uns kommen und Zuflucht hier suchen. Tatsächlich wären sie ein bisschen näher, dann hatten sie zum Beispiel sowas wie GEAS, die Reform der gemeinsamen europäischen Asylsystem, nicht beschlossen. Ja, also ich hoffe, dass das die Frage auch beantwortet. Ah, es gab hier auch eine Frage vorne und.
Okay, eine Frage an die Überlebenden. Und zwar, wir haben ja jetzt darüber gesprochen, wie das war mit dem Schiffbruch. Mich würde interessieren, wie wurden die Leute behandelt in Griechenland nach dem Schiffbruch von den Behörden und ja, welche Erfahrungen sie aus Griechenland mitbringen?
Für die Wahrheit, احنا اخذنا الخفر اليوناني على كلاماته كانت المعامله كثير سيئه جدا وضعونا بمخزن لا يصلح للجلوس فيه يعني حتى الفيران والجرابيع كانت موجوده في قلبه طبعا انا كنت مصاب بكتفي لحد الان الجراحه مبيني اسره ما قاموا بإسعافي إلى المستشفى مع أنه كنت كتير تعبان تميت لتاني نهار في اليوم الثاني حتى أني قوم على النقالة أمشي ما حسنت أمشي عليها شالوني أصدقائي اللي كانوا موجودين معي بالكام وأخذوني على المستشفى فكتير كنت تعبان وبحب أنه هاي يعني هاي أول ما جينا هيك استقبلونا والمنظمات كانت تقدم لنا أكل ما قدموا لنا شيء بالحكومة اليونانية ما ساعدونا كانت من المنظمات الأكل أثناء بالكلماتها بالمخزن وللأسف الشديد هيك كان حالنا.
Das war die gleiche Frage von vorhin. Ah, noch hier eine Frage. Hier ganz vorne.
Hello, I'm Anna Santos. I'm a journalist from Info Migrants. I'd like to know a little bit more about your country of origin and what were the if this is okay to ask also, if what the circumstances were in your countries prior to you leaving.
للأسف الشديد بلادنا قبل وبعد حاكمتها عصابات. نحن في بلدنا مثلنا مثل الاسم رقم بالسجن. وقت اللي بيعتقلوا الشخص ما بيضعوا اسمه، بيضعوا أرقام، ما في حدا يسأل عنه، ما في حدا يحاسب بلدنا المسؤولين الرئيس الموجود هناك، ما في حدا يحاسبه. للأسف الشديد أنا وقت اللي طلعت 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 من الإجرام، طلعت من القصف، من الطيران، هربنا وطلعنا. ما عندي سينكف.
أوكي. بسوا بيتوا إبراهيم.
بسبب القصف والطيران وبسبب أشياء كتير مثل الأعمار الشباب اللي بتتداوح خالص ما بين سن القانون اللي هو مجبر إنه كظلم كحكم ظالم بيجبروه على القتال وعلى إنه ياخدوا على أماكن يعني لأجل إنه يصير من سف مثلهم يعني من أشبه الميليشيات. ففي ظلم كتير ببلادنا من ناحية العصابات ومن ناحية الضرب ومن ناحية الأمان ومن ناحية في ألف شغلة وشغلة ما أنا صالحة خالص للعيشة بسوريا.
Ich meine, also grundsätzlich, wenn wir die Statistiken im Asylverfahren in Deutschland sehen, dann würden wir einfach sehen, dass von den inhaltlich überprüften Asylanträgen in Deutschland kriegen über 70% der Menschen, die hier ankommen, Aufenthaltserlaubnisse. Das bedeutet, dass diese Menschen Gründe haben, warum sie fliehen müssen. Sie haben individuelle Gründe, sie kommen aus Kriegs- und Krisengebieten. Diese ganzen Mythen über Pull-Faktoren, kann ich einfach sagen, das ist einfach nur Bullshit. Wir sprechen über Push-Faktoren, die die Menschen einfach dazu zwingen, ihre Länder zu verlassen. Niemand flieht freiwillig. Die Menschen wurden dazu gezwungen. Und das ist genau, was sowohl Überlebende, aber auch andere Geflüchtete, die in Deutschland ankommen, immer wieder berichten. Vielen Dank für Ihre Fragen, eure Fragen. Ich würde die Fragerunde an den beiden ExpertInnen, Ibrahim und Amar, schließen. Danke euch. Georg, vielleicht möchtest du was sagen, ob wir runtergehen oder.
Ich möchte mich bedanken bei euch, weil ich weiß, was es für einen Mut verlangt. Sorry. Vielen, vielen Dank. Ja, Entschuldigung, ich bin ja auch ein bisschen sehr bewegt. Wir machen jetzt einfach weiter mit der Fragerunde. Gerne auch Bemerkungen, auch gerne Beiträge zu der Frage, was können wir tun, um das zu beenden. Ich habe hier jetzt noch auf der Liste Hilde und Hans. Bitte stellt eure Fragen nochmal. Und dann meldet sich auch schon wieder jemand.
War auch, wie ging es den Überlebenden in Griechenland und vor allen Dingen, wie geht es ihnen heute, die in Griechenland geblieben sind?
Yeah. First of all, let me say that most of the survivors, if not all, that took travel documents, they left Greece. They went to find relatives and family and more supporting environments, and they didn't want to stay. Also, especially people from Egypt and Pakistan are having huge delays on their asylum processes, and two, as I said, have already been rejected, and they could face even the danger of deportation, which you can understand that especially in a case like this, that their witnesses in such a crime, they are also targeted from other people that could be quite dangerous. Those that they haven't managed to take yet travel documents and their asylum application is still pending, some of those are still in Malakasa. I don't want to speak about their lives. I can only say that they didn't have any support for their trauma. They didn't have any support for what they have been through. And this is the reality, which seems it's not only the reality in Greece, it's the reality in Europe.
Vielen Dank für den Abend. Ich hatte eine Frage zu der Klage, die vor dem Gericht in Piräus gestellt wurde. Und da würde mich interessieren, ob es juristische Einschätzungen gibt und Aussichten, gegen wen die Klage genau gerichtet ist und mit welchen Ausgängen man rechnen kann.
First of all, let me make clear that I am not a lawyer and I'm not in the legal team so that represents the survivors. So I can only tell you some things that I know. The charges are against anyone who is responsible. It's not towards specific people. This is up to the investigation to find out who were the people that were responsible for what happened on this day. Now, about the outcome, it's really hard to say. We have to wait. It's a huge case. And the efforts and the struggle of the survivors, of the families of the dead and the missing, and of course of the solidarity community, of the lawyers, of journalists, not all the journalists, of course, and media, but investigative and independent more, is raising many questions. And I think it makes it hard to just drop the case as it happened in Pharmakonisi. But no one could guarantee anything. As for the charges, if the case will proceed, the sure is that everyone is very decisive, that even if we don't have an outcome from the procedures in Greece, as it happened also in other cases like Pharmakonisi, everyone will chase, will run to the limits of the legal meanings that can be used. And of course, the European Court of Human Rights will be also one stage to proceed.
Hans, willst du deine Frage nochmal stellen?
Wie eure Anklagen, wie die Anklagen der solidarischen Menschen gegen dieses Verbrechen, wie das in der griechischen Öffentlichkeit behandelt wird von den Behörden, von der Presse, von der ja, staatstreuen Presse. Und also ich weiß, dass es ja Repressionen gab gegen solidarische Einrichtungen, wie zum Beispiel die Archäologen, die dort Veranstaltungen, die in ihrem Haus Veranstaltungen durchgeführt haben und jetzt ihr Haus verloren haben. Könnt ihr dazu was sagen, wie es damit aussieht? Wie stark ist die Unterstützung in der Öffentlichkeit? Wie stark ist der Gegenwind vom griechischen Staat?
Hello. For the event of the archaeologists, I happened to moderate the discussion there. It was the archaeologists. They have a very beautiful building, and they hosted one event which talked about the Pylos crime, as the poster was. There were many speeches, and there were also there was also a concert with some very popular and beloved artists. So the Ministry of Culture, because of this event and because the title of the event was talking about a crime, they didn't like it, and they are trying to take the building back. They haven't taken it back, but they are trying to kick the archaeologists out because they said that you cannot offend the country like that. Although that was a very big event, hundreds of people. I would say that today that we have, you know, this big memory day, I wouldn't say that the Greek media talk as much as we talk here. Migration is a very polarized thing in Greece. When we got the award with Forensis, many of the media, they had to write about the award because it was a European Parliament award. So they had to write. You cannot hide that anymore. But I wouldn't say that the majority of media, they support this quest for justice. They very often just reproduce what the Coast Guard says, and we saw that in that case as well. So whatever the Coast Guard says becomes an article. But in this case of Pylos, and I think because it's this was not just a Greek story, this was a global thing, and we had lots of colleagues from many outlets, like from Germany, ARD, Süddeutsche Zeitung, Der Spiegel, the BBC, Liberation in France, the New York Times, Washington Post, everybody was writing about it. And all of us, all these different investigations, they point to the same result. They point some investigations more, some investigations less, some with more data, but they point that this was avoidable and that actions of the Coast Guard contributed to this. So the media material is there, and we know that it does inform in the way that it can the seek for justice. But one thing is like, what are the limits? What are the limitations? Because besides the case that Ilias described, there is an investigation by the Greek Ombudsman, and this is an independent authority that by law has the right to interrogate the Coast Guard. So by law, the Greek Ombudsman can have the captain of the boat and ask him questions. It has this right. This is a very big power. But what happened is that when the Greek Ombudsman tried to do this investigation and asked, for example, what was the name of the captain, who were the people on board, the Coast Guard didn't reply. So the Coast Guard is not even accountable to the authority that by law it is accountable to. So there are very big limitations to what can happen.
Hello again. I just wanted to ask, could you give us a sense of what the sentiment is across, you know, like the Greek public in general, about Greek citizens, their view on migrants and migration, and if that has changed after Pylos?
I would not say that Greeks as a whole are racist or against migrants. I would say that a very big part of the Greek people were more supportive in, let's say, 2015, 16, 17. For example, when people from Syria were arriving back then, there was a very big wave of support, partly because also Greeks had been welcomed to Syria decades ago. And in some part, people, it's a stupid phrasing, but people got tired in some part. And to another thing is that all this migration debate, which is not even a debate, it becomes so polarized that, for example, when we reported, not only we, but when you report on the human rights abuses, which are documented, I saw it before, the Olaf report, which is not, you know, me, you, it's documented internally. When you reproduce this kind of material, then you are very easily framed as a Turkish agent, as a, you know, representing foreign interests. And this kind of rhetoric, this polarizing rhetoric, it works very well. So it manages to make people seem like they take sides. But I wouldn't say that. I mean, people were sad when it happened. People today, if I see on Facebook, people are sad that it happened. But what we are missing is this power to actually hold people that should be held accountable.
A question to the journalists, of course. Did you have any kind of hearing in the Greek parliament about this case? And since two trials are, one trial and the procedure at the Greek ombudsman is still ongoing, does your research work as an evidence on the national and European level?
We haven't been at the European Parliament yet. I don't. You went with Stefanos. So there have been some sessions at the European Parliament that we have taken part in relation to that, as well as in relation to other research that we, as forensic architecture, have done on pushbacks in the Aegean Sea, as well as in the Evros-Meris River. In relation to the Pylos 9 case, we actually prepared a 100-page report that we were ready to submit at the day of the trial, but the hearing did not take place as planned because, like it was mentioned earlier, the court, after the objections of the lawyers, accepted the objection of the lawyers that they actually don't have jurisdiction to judge the charges against the people, specifically some of the charges. So the court acquitted them. So the process did not take place as planned, but we do have the material available. And I can speak on our forensic architecture part. We will submit the work, hopefully, unless otherwise, to also the other court case that is currently pending.
Sind da noch Fragen? Habt ihr noch Fragen? Haben Sie noch Fragen?
Hello. I don't know if I got something wrong, but I wanted to ask again about the phones they confiscated from the surviving people. And I think there is no legal base to do that. And now, 1 year after, like, is there something new about that? Because this is like important evidence. And yeah, I just wanted to ask about that.
So the phones that were confiscated, and there are testimonies that they were even some of those confiscated afterwards in the hospital or in the warehouse that they were. They were found, as I said, around a month later, beginning of July, inside the plastic bag in the Coast Guard vessel that was on scene. This vessel gave the phones to the port office, the port authorities of Kythira, an island in the south of Peloponnese. And then, close to the 20th of July, they arrived to the prosecutor for the case of the nine that they were accused for smuggling and for the shipwreck. So the lawyers of the nine refugees asked repeatedly to examine the phones, and the answer was that they are completely damaged and they cannot be examined, they cannot give any evidence. Although, before examining them with special experts and special software that even the Greek Coast Guard has, this is something that you cannot say. After the trial, it was decided that these phones will be θα δημευθούνε. Πώς είναι? They will give to the state or something, which is still unclear what will happen with them. If they will go to the other trial, to the other case, because we don't know if the two cases will be unified it also regarding the material, or if they would be given back to the people. So there we are.
Gibt es noch Fragen, Bemerkungen?
Ja, ich finde es ja auch so erbärmlich, wie die Unterbringungssituation in Europa ist, auch in Deutschland. Ich habe gestern im ND einen Artikel gesehen, der ist da, also gelesen, der berichtet über die Unterbringungssituation in Berlin-Tegel. Das ist ein sehr großes Gelände, in dem Geflüchtete in 6 oder 8 Bettenräumen übereinander betten, untergebracht sind und dort wirklich so eine miesen Verhältnisse sind, dass ich mich daran erinnere, dass ich mal einen Hungerstreik von Geflüchteten in einer ganz furchtbaren Unterkunft nach außen getragen habe mit anderen zusammen, weil die haben das Essen verweigert, was vom Roten Kreuz ausgegeben wurde. Und jetzt in Tegel ist auch wieder das Rote Kreuz, die führende Organisation, was sich rassistisch damals betätigt hat und ich denke mal heute auch nicht die Rechte der Menschen zu wahren sieht, obwohl das als Rote Kreuz ja dazu verpflichtet wäre, sondern auch sich rassistisch betätigt. Und deswegen meine Frage, ob wir nicht auch alle gegen solche Zustände in Unterkünften, in Erstaufnahmeeinrichtungen, die auch hier in Berlin sind, wie in Tegel, ob wir da nicht irgendwie was gemeinsam unternehmen können, um das mehr an die Öffentlichkeit zu bringen. Auch wie ihr und die Überlebenden untergebracht worden sind. Das ist doch, es ist kriminell, es geht nicht. Ich ertrage es nicht. Ich möchte das gerne, dass wir das ändern könnten.
Thank you. I mean, I think absolutely, yes, there should be mobilization, more mobilization. I mean, there is a lot of, there is a big activist network in Germany, I'd say, in relation to migrant rights in particular and mobility across borders. But there is often the assumption that such conditions are not taking place here. And this is, of course, an assumption with also, of course, colonial underpinnings, but it has to do with the fact that Germany does have a lot of... Actually, this brings me to something that I wanted to remark before about going back to the EU hypocrisy. And the German hypocrisy in particular, since we are in Germany. And I wanted to say that the border mechanism and the inhumane border regime that the EU has established is not something that is coming out of a black hole. It actually has continuities spanning out of imperial and colonial logics, and these are seen how they are actually being reinforced through this murderous border regime. And we have, and then people are asking, why are people wanting to come to Germany or to France or to the UK or to the Netherlands? And of course, no one is asking why is stolen wealth accumulated in these countries? And of course, this has to do with the fact that these are former colonial powers. And this wealth is actually extracted and dispossessed from countries in Africa, from countries in Asia, from different places across the earth. And it's not only a matter of the past, it's actually continuing very well into the present with different foreign interventions, but also through manufacturing weapons. Germany has one of the largest arms manufacturing industries worldwide. So a lot of the weapons that are currently being used, for example, in Gaza, are manufactured in Germany or in other places, in European countries, of course, in the US, and in other places. So it is not only a complicity in manufacturing this migration crisis that the EU, of course, together with their allies, right, the Greek Coast Guard, the Libyan Coast Guard, which has been another place of externalization of the border management. But it is not only active complicity in reinforcing that through distance and the culture of impunity and having people in high places saying that, for example, Greece is the shield of Europe after massacres have taken place at the borders. It's also active complicity through a reinforcement and the maintenance of colonial hierarchies. And that is manifested very well, for example, through supplying weapons that are actually used to bomb the places where people are coming from.
Also, ich möchte sagen, dass ich sehr erfreut und auch, bewegt bin, wie viel ihr alle erreicht habt. Also, dass ihr auf der juristischen Ebene ungeheuer kompetent und schnell reagiert habt, auf der Medienebene und auch auf der Rekonstruktionsebene, wie es hier vorgetragen wurde. Und nun dieses Thema tatsächlich nach Europa getragen habt. Und ich denke doch auch mit viel Erfolg, wenn heute auch nicht so viele hier sind. Das ist nicht das Kriterium, sondern das Kriterium ist, dass jeder, der ein bisschen sich für diese Thematik interessiert, inzwischen damit konfrontiert worden ist. Und das alles als Person, die das mit Engagement und weitgehend zivilgesellschaftlich und mit wenig Unterstützung erreicht haben, das ist sehr beachtlich.
Gibt es noch Fragen, Bemerkungen? Ich sehe im Moment keine, dann bemerke ich mal selber was. Sorry. Wir haben uns natürlich auch, die Organisatoren haben uns natürlich auch Gedanken gemacht, wie es weitergeht nach dem heutigen Tag. Und wir haben eine neue Internetseite erstellt. Seht ihr hier, Pilosverbrechen. Nicht bei Google suchen, sondern in die Adresszeile, wo da HTTPS, www oder sonst was steht. Auch nicht HTTPS und www reinschreiben, sondern einfach nur pilosverbrechen.de. Dann kommt ihr zu der Seite. Da gibt es schon eine ganze Menge Informationen über das, was passiert ist. Und das wird in Zukunft weitergetragen auf das, über das, was noch passieren wird. Weil wir haben es heute gehört, es ist nicht klar, was mit dem Gerichtsverfahren wird. Es ist nicht klar, was mit dem Ombudsmannverfahren wird. Und es ist nicht klar, was mit den Protestierenden wird, weil es gibt sehr viele Proteste in Griechenland, wurde heute in vielen Orten protestiert und in Europa wurde, ich glaube, in 7, 8 Hauptstädten heute protestiert. In Pakistan wurde wahrscheinlich die größte Protestveranstaltung oder die bewegendste durchgeführt. Da haben nämlich 350 Familien sich getroffen, weil die meisten Opfer, ungefähr geschätzt 300, waren Pakistanis. Okay, ich glaube, wenn hier keine weiteren Beiträge kommen, dann bedanke ich mich sehr, dass ihr, sie gekommen seid, trotz aller Widrigkeiten, trotz des Fußballs. Mein ganz besonderer Dank geht natürlich an euch, dass ihr gekommen seid, dass ihr bereit wart zu sprechen, obwohl das traumatisch ist und ihr euch Gefahren aussetzt dadurch. Ich hoffe, dass diese Veranstaltung heute zum Kampf gegen das Vergessen beigetragen hat. Vielen Dank.